AACA Museum. My name is Jeffrey Bliemeister. I'm the museum's executive director, and I'm happy and proud to be here. We are live today at our drive-in theater in the AACA Museum. For those of you who have been here before, you know we have a real nice simulated drive-in here. We can actually program, play things on our screen, which we do when we have people have special events. We broadcast information about our exhibits. But right now, we're doing our presentation live right here in the drive-in. So we're happy to have all of you with us. Just to give everyone a heads up, not specifically a drive-in historian. I'm a trained museum professional, but I'm proud to call myself a drive-in movie enthusiast. The title for this program is Drive-In Theaters in an American Institution. And that's a little bit of a lie, but not much. Drive-ins are predominantly American in nature, and there are several reasons why. Basically, you need to have several things in place to have a successful drive-in theater culture. You have to be in a country that's rather wealthy. You have to have lots of vacant, undeveloped, and relatively inexpensive land. And that's what we had here in the United States after World War II when the drive-ins started to take off. And probably the most important aspect is you have to have people who really like their cars and have an emotional attachment to them. And that's certainly the case in the United States. We have a great car culture and history, and that's one of the reasons why this museum is here right now. A little bit of a study here. There are only three countries in the world that had any real significant drive-ins. Of course, the United States was the leader with more than 4,000 drive-in theaters at their peak in the 1960s. As Tim's gonna talk to you about a little while, there are about 300 or so that are still open in the United States. Interestingly, the top four states are New York, Pennsylvania, Ohio, and California, which account for almost 200. Which is kind of interesting because drive-ins are a seasonal business. They don't really operate during, much past the early fall in the Northeast. And Canada was number two. I was not able to find out how many they had at their peak, but they still have about 36 still in business. And interestingly, Australia is number three. That country once had about 300 drive-ins and roughly 16 are still open. The father of the drive-in is Richard Hollingshead. He's credited with that. And he actually patented or applied for and received a patent for the drive-in theater. His family was in the automobile business. And his mother, from what I understand, was a larger woman and wasn't comfortable going to a traditional theater. So her son got the idea of opening a drive-in theater. And he played around with the technology in his driveway. He would set up a camera on his car, hang a big sheet, and use a radio for his speaker. And you can see this image here is the back of the first drive-in ever opened. It was in Camden, New Jersey. It lasted about 2 years. Some more images of Hollingshead's drive-in. He was the originator. He had a struggle with all these different ways to make things happen in the drive-in. If you see from the picture, his plan was to angle the drive-in on a slope, actually have slots to drive the vehicles in and out through, and the projector was at an angle, and the cars were also tiered. Some of the things that early drive-in theater operators struggled with, probably the most interesting one, I found it, and it's an analogy to the cars as well. Back in the early days of the automobile, someone named Selden actually patented the concept of an automobile. And if you were building a car in the teens or early 20s, you had to apply for a Selden patent to produce your cars. Eventually, Henry Ford, when he was making the Model T, decided he was done with that concept. And he and other people took Selden to court, and the patent was eventually thrown out. You see some early cars have a little thing called a Selden patent plate in their dash or other part of their car. Hollingshead did the same thing. He was out of the drive-in theater business after about 2 years, but his patent was in effect for considerably time after that. The first drive-ins took off in the New England area, and some of the original ones actually applied for and received the patent from him, and they were supposed to pay him ongoing royalties as a percentage of their operation. Well, it didn't take long before the theater owners decided they didn't want to do that. So they stopped doing it. He would take them to court. He didn't get much in the way of compensation that way. And eventually his patent was voided. So some of the other things that he had to work around there, I mentioned earlier, sound. Early projection was a set of speakers hung to the drive-in tower. Of course, that has a sound delay for people that are 150, 200 yards in the back of the theater in their cars. Video required darkness, which limited the show times when you could start them and when you could hold an event. People tried unsuccessfully over the years to come up with technology that would allow drive-in movies to take place during the day. You also had to worry about birds, insects, the weather, rain, whatever, you name it, and cars leaving early with their headlights and the different problems that would cause for patrons. They found early that you could enhance your profitability through your concession stand. And they also find out quite early that attendance was strong on weekends, which is understandable with people's work schedule, and not as much during the weekdays. And then last, as I talked to you a little bit earlier, seasonality and operation in most areas of the country was rather limited due to the weather. Hollings had experimented with a 1928 Kodak projector and a radio, as I mentioned earlier. And the first change that was significant in terms of sound was in 1941 when RCA introduced the in-car speaker with an individual volume control. And that became the standard for several decades and really made the sound in your car a lot better for the patron. And also avoided local noise ordinances and other things that limited external speakers. Some images that show the speaker in your car. You know, if we had everyone here and I could see everyone, I would say, you know, we can do it for those who are here. Who in the group has been to a drive-in theater? Show of hands. A lot of been to the drive-in theater. Probably about 3/4 of the people here. You know, I brought my kids up who are now in their mid-20s on the drive-in, and they're still out there as you're going to learn today, and you're going to hear from Tim, and certainly encourage you to go out and see them when you can. But for those who are not in the modern, didn't were introduced to the drive-in, not in the modern age, but say 20 or 30 years ago, the car speaker that you hung on your door, that was the standard. Of course, they did have one drawback, which you're going to see here.
As you leave the theater, folks, please be careful. Don't let this happen to your car. Be sure to remove the speaker before you leave. If you should accidentally pull a speaker loose, please turn it in at our snack bar or box office. Thank you.
Get the concept. If you forgot and tore the speaker off the post and smashed your car, you had to do the walk of shame and take it back to the concession stand and turn it in. I don't know if there are any penalties or fees that went along with that or not, but I'm sure it wasn't a pleasant experience. The big change for that came in about late 60s or circa 1970 when radio, in-car radio could be tuned to AM and FM. There were different times periods for each, avoided the speaker on your car. And ironically, the speaker is now a collectible item, as you see here in our drive-in.
This drive-in theater is radioactive. Now you can hear tonight's show on your AM car radio. Turn your ignition key to the accessory position. This will not drain your car battery. Now turn on your radio and zero in on the following AM station.
Like a public service announcement, the drive-ins would show. And basically, it would tell you that if you tune your radio for sound, speaker sound, it would not drain your car battery, which of course all of us car people know is totally ludicrous, especially when a drive-in theater consists of two-hour plus movies. As the projection also changed, if you can see the pictures here, the traditional original theaters, drive-in theaters broadcast the same basic way as a regular indoor theater. They had these huge projection systems And they would get smaller and more efficient over time, but it wasn't until digital came in that they really changed in their essence. 35 millimeter film was shown almost from the start right up till about 2012 or thereabouts. Interestingly, when the movie industry went digital, it put a real hardship on drive-ins, as the cost to convert to digital is anywhere from $70,000 to $90,000 per screen, which is hard for a seasonal operation to make up. And Tim will probably talk about that a little bit in his presentation. But I have another video here I hope will play. Honda actually sponsored a program to try and bring digital sound to theaters.
Drive-in theaters are an American tradition, but at the end of 2013, they faced a big problem. The majority would have to shut down forever with the movie industry's switch from film to digital projection.
To upgrade, drive-ins will need to spend at least $75,000 per screen.
It's a sizable amount of money, and I'm a little guy. I just don't have that handy.
So this summer, Honda launched Project Drive-In, a movement with a simple goal: keep as many drive-ins alive as possible and preserve the tradition. Most people didn't know about the problem, so we created a mini documentary to raise awareness. We launched the campaign with a contest where 5 winning drive-ins would receive a digital projector determined by public vote. We sent the drive-ins a toolkit to campaign for themselves and mobilize their communities. And man, did they get involved.
Vote. Everybody needs to vote. If you love our drive-in, vote for us.
Follow that lead.
You can start voting to keep a honing drive-in up and running.
We set up a fund to keep more drive-ins alive, hosted the first Twitter Vine auction with film critic Leonard Maltin, and held pop-up drive-ins at Honda dealerships to get even more contributions. Within a few weeks, we sparked a national conversation.
Tonight, NBC's Randy McIlwain on how technology threatens to phase out one of our cultural icons.
Honda is trying to shine a light on the plight of American drive-ins with a new online contest.
The owners and the community are rallying around this cause to help keep this piece of history up and running.
Celebrities tweeted and made videos about it. The local communities did everything they could to help.
Rick on the top of the building, he swears he won't come down until we get a digital projector.
Drive-in fans across the country cast over 2.6 million votes. And all this passion inspired people and even other brands to contribute to the cause.
You're receiving a brand new digital projector from Project Drive-In.
Yes!
I can't believe it.
That's really incredible.
Thank you so much for saving our very own drive-in.
From the slide, that project was very successful, and they actually saved, I think, 4 or 5 times more than they started out with their intention. Interestingly, there's one drive-in still that has not gone digital. It's in Mahoning, Pennsylvania, which is up in the Pocono Mountain area, and Mahoning plays nothing but 35 millimeter movies. So they're on my list to go see this summer. They're one of the places I have not visited. When drive-ins first took off and started to be built, they ranged in size from the very small to the extremely large. And I'm going to show you some illustrations of all those. This is the all-weather drive-in, which was in metropolitan New York area. It was so big, it could accommodate about 3,000 cars for drive-in night. It also had a tram to take you around to the playground, indoor restaurants, other attractions. And it had an indoor theater for the days when it was raining or people just wanted to see a movie in a conventional way. It closed in the late 70s when land prices put it out of business. The pictures, again, I was talking about show it could accommodate about 3,000 cars. Interestingly, the smallest drive-in I found that's still open is in Queensland, Australia. It has space for 36 cars, but it also has a grandstand. So I'm not sure I'm going to get to that one, but you never know. Smallest one I found currently in the United States is still open, is in Briggs, Idaho. It can handle 60 cars. It obviously has a potato theme, and they have a series of cabins. So they must be catering to people like me that are driving nuts, because you could spend the night there if you travel some distance. This is my personal anecdote here. You know, driving in vehicles for me have changed over the ages. My first memories are in my family's Ford station wagon in my pajamas. Of course, when I became driving age, my favorite vehicle to take was the blue Mustang. And more recently, it was the Volvo station wagon with my kids. You know, when you get to the drive-in, there's a lot of things involved in the experience. You want to get there early and pick a prime spot. I think we're a little too early that day, but. You know, as I mentioned, a lot of playgrounds were developed by theaters because they wanted something for the kids to do to keep them entertained before the drive-in movie started. And as time went on and competition got more fierce from other attractions, a lot of drive-in theater owners started doing promotions of all types. And I'm sure Tim will mention some of the ones he is currently at Skyview.
The show starts in 5 minutes. The show starts in 4 minutes. The show starts in 3 minutes. The show starts in 2 minutes. The show starts in 1 minute. And now, on with the show.
Typical drive-in experience was two movies, often a first-run feature and one that was just a little bit older. And that's a much condensed version of what would be shown. And it's still shown at many drive-ins locally. Usually intermission's about 15 minutes and entertainment's provided on screen. So we cut that one down considerably. Another American institution is the Beach Boys, and I'm gonna play you a song called Drive-In. They put it out in the mid-60s. It's a really good summary of the drive-in experience in under 2 minutes. Just down Route 83, it was served as the inspiration for our snack bar here. We kind of modeled ours after what they have. They've been in continuous operation since 1953. Midway Drive-In in Mifflinburg, that's one I have not visited. I hope to get to sometime soon. Cumberland Drive-In is just down Route 81, opened in 1952. You'll see the, these dates here, there's kind of a theme. That's one I have been to. It's a very nice drive-in. Probably the biggest one in our immediate area is the Pike, which is in Montgomery, just a few miles from Williamsport. The Pike has three screens and can accommodate 600 cars, which is pretty big for today's drive-ins. And of course, the Skyview, which we're going to hear more about very, very soon. And that'll be on my list of places to go, and hopefully I'll get there during opening week. A little bit on drive-in theater culture. You know, the drive-in has, like I said, it's an iconic part of America. It has a lot of associations. For those familiar with Greece, we have a short video on Greece. It was a way to create instant family time on your own terms. No formal dress was required. No babysitter was needed because you could bring the kids with you. Some theaters, as I mentioned previously, added playgrounds, mini golf, special attractions, bargain nights, and other gimmicks to attract patrons and visitors. And one of the things that also helped the drive-in theater was initially it was not as dramatically impacted as traditional theaters by the advent of television after World War II. The decline of drive-ins can be contributed to many different things. With attendance really starting to drop in the late 60s and on into the early 70s. Advances in color television followed by cable, and now we have streaming and downloads and everything. They all contributed to the drive-in's demise. The energy crisis didn't help. And then the adoption of daylight savings time pushed the start time back an hour. So that didn't help either. Another thing that we're not going to get into any detail here, but in the 70s, some of the venues switched their viewing to X-rated films to bolster sagging attendance. That resulted in some legal problems, loss of families, and some community issues, depending on where they were located. And then, of course, the big one I talked about, increasing taxes and land values and development really, really hampered the drive-in's existence. This is a picture I took from the back of my car at the Pike Drive-In for the anniversary in 2008. Unfortunately, I have not been to the drive-in as much as I would like to, so this has got me enthusiastic about doing more going forward. Drive-ins made a little bit of a comeback 2 years ago, and I know Tim is going to talk about this. With traditional theaters closed during the pandemic and live concerts not possible, many, many prominent artists did different programs that were broadcast at the drive-in as a safe, socially safe venue. And the list of performers is pretty big, including Garth Brooks made a big deal out of it. I know one of our staff members went to the drive-in to see that concert live. Live at the drive-in with Garth Brooks. And with that, I think I'm about done. I'm gonna turn it over to Tim to talk about the Skyview. Welcome, Tim.
Good morning, and thanks for coming out. I tell you, to me, drive-ins have been a part of my life since I was 7 years old. I went to my first drive-in movie at the Eden Drive-In, and my dad worked long-distance construction. So that stuck with me the rest of my life. When Project Honda started, I started looking for closed drive-in, and at the time, Project Honda, there were 500 drive-ins. During that time, we lost about 175 drive-ins. So my goal was to bring one back to life. It took almost 8 years to find one that we could rehab and bring back to life. The biggest thing that caused the issue was once they closed, if there was families involved, I'll give you an example. You got the siblings. Well, one wants to sell, one wants it to open again, and the other one's unsure. There's a lot of drive-ins that are in that situation now. They're sitting there closed. They can open up again. Well, when I first came to the Skyview drive-in, the family said no because I had no experience. And what helped me out was two of the drive-ins I went to the Cumberland drive-in, and I went to the family drive-in, and I got to know the owner and the projectionist. Both of those men were mentors, and one of them stood up and said, hey, don't worry, I won't let Tim fail. I'll teach him what he needs to help him run the drive-in. And that still holds me today. The one great thing about anybody running these theaters, it's like a community. These guys will help each other out. I'll never forget my opening night. A lot of my stuff didn't show up for that evening. Simple things as popcorn tubs, bags. One of the owners drove 4 hours to come up and stayed with me the whole evening to make sure we got on the screen. It is a fun experience. It really is. When you're in the background, for me, it's stressful but fun. And I'll give you an example. Just like you see this image on the screen, you have it in your mind what a perfect evening is. And what I mean by a perfect evening, when you're getting there, you want the popcorn smell to be in the air, the butter going, the grill with burgers, fries, and you don't want anybody to worry about anything. And you just want them to show up and the picture goes on the screen. And that's one of the good and the bad things of digital. It gives you a beautiful picture, but it's also stressful. It's either going to work or it's not going to work. I'll give you a good example. One evening, I'm in the projector room and I'm getting ready to change over for the second movie. And I look on the floor and I got this puddle. And I thought, what could that be? Lo and behold, it's antifreeze leaking from the projector. So there I sat on the floor as my daughter kept pouring antifreeze in as I held the hose for 2 hours so the projector wouldn't overheat. Oh my gosh, I thought that had to be the longest 2 hours of the drive-in. And the first night I opened as well, one of the craziest things was, like he had mentioned earlier, was the FM transmitter. That's how we broadcast the sound out. Well, evidently, I didn't have mine set to a strong enough station. I had cowboy country coming on the front side, and I had gospel coming in the back, and Captain America playing in the middle. I was so fortunate that people were forgiving for the most part. And one of the things I can always say about the drive-in right now is the drive-ins are in one heck of a fight. The COVID was good for it, brought attention. But what's going on now is, the second year of COVID, what occurred was streaming. And what I mean by that, with the streaming, they think everybody wants to sit at home and watch the movies. Well, the thing to me that I'm passionate about is the last 300, I want to see them survive for years. I don't want to see that number drop. I want to see it continue. And I think now, like this young man sitting over here, someday, just like Dee Vogel said, down at the Benji's drive-in, he has seen parents that came out as teenagers to his drive-ins that are now married, having kids, and those kids have grown up. So he's been there for 4 or 5 generations now. And for me, I just want to see another group grow up and be able to have the drive-in there. And I really am passionate about that because to me, when I open this up and I see the families come out, I get excited, especially when I see that first car come to the ticket booth and I'm like, there we go. We're still find a way to cling on to what is precious about yesterday. It's family time. It's quality time. It's enjoying movies. And whether you're sitting in your car, outside the car, you're immersed with your family. I one time had a father, never been to a drive-in, brought his son out. And he's like, what do we do now? I told him, I said, well, first put the cell phone in the car. Here's a football. We got a whole back lot to throw the ball. Go out there with your son. At the end of the night, he came up to me. He said, this is the best experience I had. I said, it's not about the movie. It's the time together. And to me, I love it. I really do. The fight that we're in, the struggle we're in, it's worth it. It's more so now because I'll give an example like Maryland. Another drive-in will not open in Maryland. And that is just because of the zoning. Pennsylvania has a lot of drive-ins for the fact that they're a lot easier on the zoning. And I'll give you an example. The Moonlight Drive-In in Wyoming, PA, came back after 28 years of being closed. He's now open and running. He sat there with a lot that had been overgrown for 28 years, and now it's back. And I run my drive-in with my family. My son's in the ticket booth. My wife's at the register. My social butterfly, my daughter started there at 6 years old. She's now 11. And when I first opened the drive-in, I work at a school district in Maryland, and the drive-in was a side project. Like I said earlier, it was about bringing one back to life. And when I spoke to the family, I told them, I said, whether I succeed or fail, I want someone to see it one more time before it's gone. And one time in our area, there were four drive-ins. There was one in Halifax. There was one in Pine Grove. There was one in Williamstown. And there was me. Now there's only one. And when you think about that, like you had mentioned earlier, there was 4,000 drive-ins in America. Every small town, every community had a drive-in. And now there's 300. One of the goals of the drive-ins running is we're trying to say, hey, find someone to run your drive-in. Some are going to sell because they want to retire. Now some, they want to do the part where we want to find someone like myself. Hey, let's sell it at a drive-in price to keep it running. When I see a drive-in price, we're not saying 1.2 million. That's not sustainable. When I say a drive-in price, we're saying $200,000 to $500,000 to try to keep that drive-in going because of land values. And one of the things that's now also facing drive-ins is laser projectors. Now, all of us are in the same boat. As he had mentioned earlier, a digital projector is $100,000. Now, with that going to the laser, that is sitting at $250,000. A bulb for my projector is about $1,000. And so where the rubber meets the road is with the studios that you work with, they take the ticket. You might get 50 cents to a dollar off that ticket, and they expect you to make it on concessions. And so in the old days, you could picnic style, tailgate at the drive-ins. Well, right now, it's like re-educating your audience to have them understand that's how we live and die. We live by the concessions. I tell you what, in my drive-in theater, I've seen some amazing things. I've had patrons come out to the evening, and I had one patron jump on the line and start helping me. Just as soon as I had the line out the door, I was falling a little bit behind, and they just jumped on the line. I've had some patrons, one night, my ice machine's not working. One young lady, her dad came out and got my ice machine working right in the middle of the show. And I've always been so grateful because that's what the drive-in is. It's the community. And whether you come to, doesn't matter, as long as you go to one somewhere in America while you can still see it. And right now, I think there's four or five up for sale. We lost a couple this year. And, for me, it's a special place. It really is. When you see the cars pulling up and you're watching the evening it start and the picture comes on the screen, one of my favorite things to do is to take a staff member out to the lot. I have them walk with me, and I want them to understand when I walk that lot, I want you to listen to the people talking in their cars about the movie. I want them to see what's going on because I want them to understand it's not a popcorn you sold. It's not the hamburger you sold. It's about the experience that we provided for that evening. And that's what's important. It's about keeping that tradition of yesterday, that little bit of Americana that's still there, you know? And it's like, I always tell people, because once it's gone, it's forever gone. You're not getting it back. Because I can tell you, for me, trying to get one of these open, I went to one place in State College, and I'm sitting there at the table getting ready to ink the deal, and the guy was honest. He said, Tim, if I get a box store, you're gone. And it really saddened me because that there was a small community that had a drive-in, and now it's forever gone because in their mind, they wanted a box store. Another example of that is Lancaster, PA. They had a drive-in up to 2007. They sold the drive-in, and they tried to get it back. They had a change of heart. Now it's been grazed, and it's just sitting there. No housing development, nothing happened. So I always tell people, even if you go once a year, go out with your family, spread the word, because these things are, I'll give you an example, Virginia's down to 5, North Carolina's down to 4 or 5. And those are, and it's very hard to build one up. And I tell you, it is a beautiful experience. I'll give you an example for us. Last year, We ran all the way to Thanksgiving weekend. I thought my wife was going to kill me, to be honest with you, because most drive-ins are done in September. But for me, once you get it in your blood and you see that picture on the screen, there's nothing greater than seeing cars come out. So we just keep running until the last car comes out. Right here is a great example. This man right here is Fred Wonders from the Cumberland Drive-In. And I met Fred probably 20 years ago when I first moved here from Roanoke, Virginia. Came here after college, and I went to Fred, and he started talking to me about the projector. And Fred started working with me. He said, "Tim, you really want to open one?" This man stood beside me all the way for the past 20 years till I finally one got off the ground. And this bulb that he's holding, these are xenon lamp bulbs. This is a great example. These bulbs are, when I first got in this, they were 1,400. Now they're about 900. So when I say concessions are important, they really are. These bulbs are so terrifying. I got to be honest with you. You can find really cool videos on YouTube when these bulbs. So when I was talking about antifreeze and I was talking about, we're running about 6,000 watts in these projector rooms. So when they went from 35 millimeter to digital projector, those 35 millimeters, they could be dirty. It could be hot. It could be cold. And you're going to get a picture on the screen. These 35s, projector room can't get colder than 60 or 55 in the wintertime. Somebody's got to keep the heat rolling. Summertime, these rooms cannot get hotter than 80. They start to get hotter than 80, that projector is going to restart. And the crazy thing is, as soon as it restarts, it leaves a little spot on the, it could possibly leave a little spot on the screen. More it restarts, the bigger that spot gets, because that's your primary colors. Not to get too technical, but it's amazing with these projectors. They have multiple fans trying to cool them down, and there's so much involved. So that was a big thing. A lot of the folks that came from the 35 millimeter world that came to digital, it was retraining the mind to understand these things are very temperamental. You go in there, it's not like a 35, 99% of the time it's going to go your way. But these, I'll give you an example. You get a hard drive. I lightly bumped the computer one night. I hit it right in the middle of intermission, which was the best time to hit it, to be honest with you, because it restarted right in the middle of intermission, then it came back. One night, I lost my whole thing. I never forget, Disney required everybody take an update. You're not going to believe what happened. Right in the middle of the movie, this computer restarts, and I was so fortunate. It came right back in the same spot of Jurassic Park. My little girl learned her first bad word that night. So it wasn't for me. It was from one of the patrons that said, "Hey, you ruined my movie." I was like, "No, it didn't. We went back to the same spot." And the one thing that we do at the drive-in, all drive-ins, is we do car shows, we do trunk or treats. Oh my gosh, my favorite event is Christmas time. I get excited when we bring the hay wagon out, we bring Santa out in the fire truck. One of my favorite times is those times of the year where we really get the families out there and we try to celebrate those periods together. Trunk or treat is a blast. It really is. The families dress up, the cars are dressed up. We do contests and we do triple features. We start off with a cartoon-like, and then we go to a teen, and then we go to an adult. And Christmas time, we play triple features throughout the whole weekend. Santa stays with us. The local fire company, Gratz PA, brings the Santa on the fire truck. Last year, they brought Santa and the Grinch out, and the kids get to ride the fire truck with Santa. It is super cool. It really is. And I'll tell you, right there, there's nothing cooler when you're sitting in the evening getting ready for the picture hit the screen. And it is a beautiful experience. Where we're at in rural PA, it is beautiful. There's no ambient light coming out on the screen. It is pitch black. So if you're coming from Harrisburg or other cities and you're not used to that, it is a beautiful night out there at the drive-in. And so for me, I really hope that this year that you would go out to a drive-in, take your family out there, take your kids out there, and they still experience. We show a wide range of movies from the beginning to the end of the year. And I can't stress enough, it is an awesome experience. One of my mentors, he bought one of his drive-ins. He was the only guy that bought a drive-in off of eBay in Raleigh, North Carolina. He bought a drive-in. And the crazy thing was he went into the bank and he said, "Can I get a loan for this drive-in?" Then he bought off eBay. And he said, "Well, we don't do loans for drive-ins." And he ended up having to get funding another way. But it was fascinating. He bought the only one off eBay. And I'll give you a little thing about this digital. Warner Brothers, a group of drive-in owners, these digital projectors were not meant for drive-ins. The goal was to shut the drive-ins down, was to put them out. And they basically told drive-in owners, these digital projectors weren't meant for you. They're not for you. They're for the indoors. And one of the things that they said was, guess what? You drive-ins don't move the needle. But if we look back in history, when there was 4,000, the drive-ins carried Hollywood when there was 4,000 drive-in movie theaters. And so in 2020, when the walk-ins couldn't open, who helped Hollywood out? That was drive-ins. And so it's kind of sad that last year, Hollywood wants to try the streaming. And I still think to myself, who wants to do everything in your home? You want to get out. And it's not just drive-ins that are having a struggle. It's your bowling alleys. It's your skating rinks. Little pieces of Americana that I would still like to see exist today. And the drive-ins are just special. They really are. Everyone. Oh, yes. If you go to skyviewdrivein.com, and you can Google us on Google us as well, Skyview Drive-In Gratz, PA. You can find us there. And our menu's online. We have burgers. Oh my gosh, we have an amazing menu. We do food specials throughout the evening. You don't even have to fix dinner. Do not dress up, okay? That is the drive-in tradition. Do not dress up. Show up as you are and come out and put it all on us. We're gonna make sure you have a great evening out there at the drive-in. It is a special place. We're gonna open up April the 8th. And our first showing is gonna be Sonic 2. And after that, we're going to go to Doctor Strange May the 2nd, but we got about 10 movies to show in April between the first of the month and the month. Crazy thing is, right now in my house, the discussion is when to open. As you know, you guys come up, some folks that come up to my drive-in, they'll realize there's a little tug of war in my family. I could run all year long. Now, my wife on the other end, if you see me keeping my distance, that's because she's like, hey, Tim, it's either time to close or I wasn't ready to open. And so I'm kind of fortunate. My family's with me. A lot of drive-ins. It's the husband and wife team. One either loves it, one hates it because it's a lot of work. My wife likes it. She just doesn't like when I try to run to December. I look at it this way. As long as they're willing to come out. And oh, that's right. Like you said, sometimes the car batteries die. That's okay. Don't get upset. I got you. I got two jump packs. I'll get your car started. We never leave anyone behind. And we actually live in Chambersburg. We travel about an hour and a half to get there on Fridays. We have a camper on site and we stay there. So it's a total passionate project. And what you're going to see about any drive-in owner you meet, it's a guy like me, a husband and wife team that are running these. There is no corporation running a drive-in. The family that we worked with to get the Skyview drive-in, that one time they had 75 movie screens. A big company bought those and they didn't want the drive-in. So that's why I said, when you go to these drive-ins, you're going to see a different personality, a different something. All of us are different. But what you're going to see unique is a mom and pop guy like myself running that. And please make sure you go out there and visit them. I can't stress it enough. The picture is beautiful. If there's one positive to the digital, it is that beautiful picture. We are running 6,000 to 7,000 watts of light to that screen. Whereas 35 millimeter, the prints are now older. There's no prints. That's one thing I can also bring up about 35 millimeter. When you saw Project Honda, Kodak actually had film sitting in a warehouse. They had enough film to go several more years. They didn't have to put 200 drive-ins out of business. So it was not exactly honest. The goal was it saved them, saved the industry $4 billion. So I get that point, but that a lot of that film was just sitting there. Quentin Tarantino actually requested his film, some of his movies, to be on 70 millimeter. The crazy thing is they had to find projectionists to still run that. The other week ago, I was at Benji's drive-in. I still have my 35 millimeter hooked up. He said, this summer, Tim, if you want to, I still have film. I'll be happy to put some on the screen for you. So I got to be honest, I'm going to try it out. I just want people to see it one more time, the 35 millimeter. The screen is actually A100 flat paint. You try to get it as flat as you can. And then we just shine the light. We project the light right on it. The main thing is there cannot be any light from any other angle. I'll give you an example. There's a couple drive-ins that had a Lowe's or Walmart come on the backside of it, and they had the parking lot lights, and that took out some of the light. The other thing I saw, one of the questions there was about a drive-in website that lists all of them. Coming in May, there will be a drive-in website I'm going to put on Facebook and our website as well, and it's going to be authentic drive-ins. It's going to list the remaining 200 drive-ins. At the one in Pittsburgh, the Twin Highway, that drive-in had been closed for a few years, and a guy had brought that drive-in back, and it sat on 27 or 30 acres. What happened was the owner sold it after he had just put in the second screen to a sheets. What didn't make sense was he could have left the drive-in on the front side, but the sheets on the back side, and the drive-in could have lived. But instead, they closed the drive-in down. That screen, one of the screens went to Becky's, and the equipment went to another drive-in as well.
So between Mr. Jeff and Mr. Tim, I think we've found out today there's some real drive-in historians, and they know a real piece of Americana, and it would be great for us here at the AACA Museum to continue to help support one another and preserve that. So don't forget, you will find this video to be at your disposal to play back again. But as you come to the museum here, it's easy to become a member. You can go to our website and click on Join Support. You can get a membership inexpensively, bring your family here, bring friends here. You can donate, and your corporate or your business can do the same as well. Get yourself a corporate membership, bring your employees. It's a fun place, just like American drive-ins.
Jeff, again, I just want to thank everyone for their attention today. And Tim, thank you for joining us. Looking forward to seeing the sky view. I appreciate your support of the museum. Everyone out there, thank you for being part of this, and we'll see you again next time.